Last week, we talked about this idea of being set free, what it means to be set free from the bondage of slavery of sin, from the penalty of sin. And one of the images that has stuck with me throughout this week, I know it was something I said, so it sounds a little bit self-aggrandizing to say I've been thinking about my message all week, but here's the case. The idea last week that we discussed of living like a freed slave has been with me. It has reverberated with me throughout the week of, and every day trying to kind of imagine what that means for me as someone who has experienced the grace of Christ coming and changing my life. What does it look like to then live like someone who has been set free, a freed slave? There has to be nothing more liberating, no feeling that's more amazing than to be liberated from slavery. And as I was discussing this, and we were deciding this was the celebration of our salvation is what we were talking about. As we live like slaves, there's a celebration, or of freed slaves, there's a celebration of what Christ has actually done for us. So that when we are out in the community, when we're discussing our faith with other people, when we talk about the salvation, we talk about coming to know Jesus Christ as our Savior and as our Lord, we develop the attitude of celebration of those who have been set free. That's what we discussed last week, and it just continue to stick with me this week. And as I'm developing this message this week and all this idea of what it means to live like someone who has been set free. I am I like to think of myself as a rebel by nature, but I reflected on myself, on my life this year, or this week, and I don't, I think I'm more of a rebel in my head than in reality. Like, and that's probably good for all of us, that I am more rebellious in there. But I was thinking, I remember when I was in junior high school, I kind of, and most of us go through this, most guys maybe a little bit more than ladies, but I think we all do. There was a point at which I decided that my parents were idiots and that everything that they stood for was absurd. And maybe I arrived at that a little bit later than others and earlier than others, but that was my mindset. And so in my life, and this included faith and all this, in my mind and in my behavior, I began to develop an attitude of rebellion. And when we think about rebels, okay, when you think about, if you're a Star Wars person, I know what you think about. If you think about Civil War, I know what you're thinking about. When you think about people now, when you see movies or news articles about people who are rebels, there are all kinds of different ideas. And the idea of rebellion is this idea of people who are fighting for freedom. And I developed that attitude. That was my mindset. I was going to break free of all of those things that had kept me in bondage for the 13 years of my life. And I decided I didn't like my parents' music. I didn't like, there's a good reason for that, but I didn't like my parents' music. I didn't like the rules that had been set on me, and I was going to do everything possible to break those rules at every possible opportunity. I was at the Christian school for 2 years, basically took the same attitude and was in detention a lot, like record-breaking levels of a lot. I did that because I thought in my mind I was trying to be free. I was going to make the decisions for myself. And so often when we think about rebels, that's what we think about. But what I've realized in my own life is even those people who are rebellious in their heart and mind are not free. We are just slaves to something else. We have bought in to a different mindset. And I realized when I got to the place in my life that I realized my own rebellion was actually doing me no good. My own attitudes were not actually positively affecting my life. I realized it was time to change and let go of the rebellion in my own heart and give my heart to Christ. And when he set me free, it was a major change. And I realized that what I had to do is, I wasn't to give up my freedom in my attitude was not necessarily to become independent of rules and laws and boundaries and all of those types of things. See, a lot of times we think freedom equals independence, right? And we're Americans, so that's what we think. We have a Declaration of Independence that describes our freedom. But when we look at the Declaration of Independence and what it lays out, then we look at the resulting Constitution and the laws and bylaws and all those types of things, we realize that freedom does not mean that you are independently able to do whatever you want, whenever you want, at the detriment of any other people around us. And I had to learn that myself. Now, I still have a little bit of that contrary nature, that's putting it delicately. I have that. There are still initial responses. When I am in a situation and people tell me to do something, my immediate response is to not do it in my head. As a mature person, I realize that's not always the best thing to do, and I will go on. And God has helped me with that and has humbled me with that attitude so many times in my life to realize that just because I don't want to do something or just because I am not comfortable with something, I have subjugated myself willfully to the message and the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the message of Jesus Christ is not rebellion. It is not contrarianism. It is not fighting for the sake of fighting. And I struggle with that still today. But God works through that, and it's an amazing way. And when we all have different responses. That's my response. And even as a Christian, when I first gave my heart to Christ, and I started basically deconstructing even all of the things I had learned as a child, because I wanted to be right in my faith, but I still had a very negative attitude, I guess, sometimes. And I struggled with those things. And some things as I studied Scripture and things, I've realized, you know, they weren't biblical. They were traditions and different things like that. And other things I realized were true. But that was my response. And sometimes, even as Christians, we can be rebellious. We know what Scripture says, but we want it to agree with what we think. We know what the right thing to do is, but we also know what's convenient for us and what we like to do. Others of us will fall into legalism, okay? That when we become Christians, it's very easy to do the same thing that many other folks do. In our freedom, we get a list of rules that we follow, and these are the things that make Jesus happy. And if we break those rules that make Jesus happy, then Jesus is not happy, and he sends us to hell or hits us with lightning bolts, as has been implied on Facebook recently. Okay? That's not the idea, but we get into that. And what we do is we give the freedom that Christ has offered us and the freedom that we have experienced, and we trade it for a different kind of slavery. Others of us get into this idea of moralism. As long as everything looks right, and as long as everything is going okay, Jesus is happy, God is happy with me, and I'm doing the right things. I was reading an article this week about the idea of being a good moral person, and it was written from the perspective of a Southerner, and the Southerner said that, this guy said that when you were, look at people's kids in the South, they make a determination of whether or not you're good parents by the behavior of your kids, and when they look at the kids, they say, those kids were raised right. They were raised right. And that's why they do what they do. If people would have looked at me as a junior high student and as a high school student, they would have thought I was not raised right. There are some of you who probably still think that. But we go into this idea of moralism. We want everything to look good. That's why so many churches, even this one at times, falls into the trap of doing self-help type of series. Because we want you to have good relationships. We want you to have financial freedom. We want all of those things to happen because those are good things. But because of it, we decide that we are going to trade the freedom that Christ has offered us for slavery of moralism. Slavery of looking good. Slavery of hitting all of the right marks. And that is not freedom. Others of us fall into this other trap of indifference. We have been set free by Christ. We have experienced the saving faith of Christ in our own lives, and then we move into this idea of just not caring. Indifference is slavery. So today, what we need to realize, what I hope you walk away with is this: freedom that is not controlled, freedom that is just running rampant, is not and goes into all of these other places. And if we do not find a way to define our faith, define what it means to be free in Christ, we will continue to struggle, and eventually we will end up slaves to something else. Freedom must have definition. I wish he was here this morning, because I would pick on him. Josh Curry is a bodybuilder. He's a really good friend of mine. I love him. He's a bodybuilder. He does competitions. And when he is getting ready for the competition, first of all, kid works out all the time and eats crazy stuff. But when he's getting ready for a competition, he does everything possible to eliminate all of the excess fat, which I don't know that he has a lot, excess water, anything there is to define those muscles. When they go to those competitions, his dad Mark is here. He's gone to some of the competitions. What they are being judged on is if you can see those muscles in his body. And they do everything possible. And if you watch what those guys go through, it is insane to get to the point of cutting weight and everything. But the whole purpose is that you can see the work that they have put in, and you can see the definition of every single muscle. And there are, you see the boundaries. You see where the muscle begins and where the muscle ends. That's definition. And when we are followers of Christ, we must also understand that our faith must have definition. We must know where it ends and where it begins. Where it starts, where it finishes, we must understand the importance of a defined faith. Other places we talk about boundaries. Right, and it's weird that you would think about talking about freedom and talking about boundaries, but it's important to understand where you believe, what you believe. We've looked at this over the last couple weeks. You've seen there through on many different places, very many different media sources, that there are a lot of people swayed by what's happening politically and all those types of things. And many people, many Christians, if you would ask them, they cannot tell you their opinion because their faith is not defined. We must have a defined faith. Your freedom must have definition. So, in order to live like free people, we must first be liberated. In order to be a freed slave, there must be someone who frees you. So we're going to read this scripture this morning just as a reminder of who it is who frees us. What it is that has instigated this change in our lives. And if you go to 1 Peter chapter 2. Now, if you have your Bible this morning, good, okay? Because we're going to be going some other passages. There's only going to be one set of scriptures on the screen, and that's this one. The rest of them, you're going to either have to use your phone or use the old school method and look them up as we read them. But this was the one we're going to do. 1 Peter chapter 2, starting with verse 21. Is it not up there either? Okay, well, we're going to do everything old school this morning then. Okay. 1 Peter chapter 2. For God called you to do good, even if it means suffering, just as Christ suffered for you. He is your example, and you must follow in his steps. I think it's the first definition. He never sinned, nor ever deceived anyone. He did not retaliate when he was insulted, nor threaten revenge when he suffered. He left his case in the hands of God, who always judges fairly. He personally carried our sins in his body on the cross, so that we can be dead to sin and live for what is right. By his wounds, you are healed. Once you were like sheep who wandered away, but now you have turned to your shepherd, the guardian of our souls. When we look at this idea of being free people, we must never forget he who set us free. And that is Jesus Christ. It says he bore our sin when he went to the cross. By his wounds, you are healed. By his wounds, you are set free. He is our liberator. He is the foundation of everything we believe. If we forget that, if we forget what Christ has done for us, we forget how to live like free people. But also, if you remember correctly, as our liberator, one of the interesting things about Jesus is he's also a great example of what we should be, how our faith should define us. And when Jesus is talking in Matthew 20, which we're not going to read, but it's on your weekly reading this week, if you read it, when Jesus is talking in Matthew 20, he says, if you are going to be my disciples, if you want to be held in with regard in my kingdom, you will be a servant. Why? Because he was a servant. You will serve others. There's a whole conversation there where guys are trying to be higher on the level, in the level in the kingdom of Christ. And he says, you come the way I come. You serve the way I serve. Not only is he our liberator, not only was Christ the one who sets us free, he did it through the image, through the life of a servant. That's an amazing idea. How many servants do you know whose goal would be to come through and to liberate all of the other servants so that he would sacrifice himself for that? But that is who Christ is. He is our liberator, but he is also one of the first examples of our definition of our faith, because Christ is our servant. He served us. He came not to be served, but to serve. And that is a huge part of this whole idea of our faith, of acting like free people. It's a weird idea. Let's face it. A weird concept. It's actually a solely Christian concept that in order to be a leader, in order to be someone who is free, that you will subjugate yourself willfully to be a servant of other people. Any place else you see that in the world, any other conversations about volunteerism or any of those types of things are centered in the gospel of Jesus Christ. He came not to serve, to be served, but to serve. And as we exercise our freedom, as we find ways to define who we are as Christians, we must always go back to Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve. He is our liberator. He did everything necessary to set us free. And if we have accepted that this morning, we are free people. But there are other things, other examples from Scripture of what our liberator looks like, because I think free people will live like the liberator. If you are set free from something, And someone has been the source of that for you. They have been the one who has set you free. You will look to them to see what a free person looks like. And when we look at Christ, we learn that we should also live like the liberator, not only as a servant, but as a lover, as someone who loves other people. The song this morning, "Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out." Jesus says in John 15, they will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. You will be known by your love. Christ loved every person he ever came into contact with. Did he always agree with them? No. Did he ignore sin? No. But he loved them. And if we are free people, we will live like the liberator. And we will love those around us. Jesus was also, and this is something, and we'll talk about it. He was also a doer. James 1 talks about not just being hearers of the word, but also doers. Because our faith has definition, right? We don't just speak the, we don't just talk the talk, we walk the walk. We don't just hear great messages or read scripture that we take in and it actually applies to our lives, right? That's who we are. And our great example of that is still Jesus, right? Jesus still lived like someone who followed the prompting of the Father. Jesus was still someone who did not glory in sinfulness. It actually says in 1 Peter what we just read, he was without sin. He did not sin. Now we know as Christians and as fallen people that that's not what we're talking about here. And I'm not talking about the idea that as a free person you have to do X, Y, and Z. And it's a very difficult tension to be someone who lives like a free person and lives like the liberator, but doesn't fall into one of those things, those traps we talked about before of legalism or moralism. But if you go through, if you read what Jesus said, because a lot of people nowadays really want to paint Jesus as just a, I love you regardless, go do what you need to do, and I'll be perfectly happy when it comes to the end, it all comes out in the wash. And I love you, and you all get to go to heaven, and I'm cool. But that's not the way Jesus acted. We talked about it a couple weeks ago. His response to someone caught in sin was to forgive them, but then to tell them there's a different way. You don't need to live that way anymore. So we are people who should pursue righteousness, not rules, not regulations, but righteousness, the idea of being right with God, of pursuing what it means to be someone who lives like the liberator. And it's interesting to me because once you learn how to live like a liberator, like the liberator, once you start trying to really get in tune with the message of Jesus, one of the other things that happens is free people of God learn to live like the liberator, but they also learn to be free together. They learn to be free together. Now, I don't know, I haven't done enough historical research to see what it looks like, but I'm pretty sure, I know that in Vinton, there's a former settlement of freed slaves that had started a town out there, right? What's the name of it? It's the churches out there, right? The Bethel Church. That's where Lesher's buried. But there's a whole settlement, and when they moved together. They came here together because they were learning to be free folks together. And when I look at Scripture, when I hear the conversations of other people, when I look at churches that are growing together and not just growing in numbers, but growing in their faith, and they're talking about this, one of the things I see is that the people who have been set free by Christ are learning to be free together. They do not learn to do it independently. They do not do it away, free from other folks. They do it together. And if you look at this idea, we call it in churches, we call it community. And you hear it a lot. We actually have an entire team discussing building community at this church. And we're working on different things through it always. But I want to look at a passage from Galatians. Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. You ever feel like you've just got so much to say that you can't keep track of where you are? That's kind of where I am this morning. There's so much coming in. Galatians 5, 13. You've been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters, but don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another in love. For the whole law can be summed up in this one commandment, love your neighbor as yourself. If you're always biting and devouring one another, watch out. Beware of destroying one another. So I say, let the Spirit guide your lives. You won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. The sinful nature wants to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are the opposite of what the sinful nature wants. These two forces are constantly fighting each other. You're not free to carry out your good intentions. But when you're directed by the Spirit, you are not under the obligation of the law of Moses. Let the Spirit guide your lives, and you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. For you've been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters, but don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another in love. There is, and if you go, there, this is one of tons of stories, of verses, entire passages about this importance of coming together in community. Free people learn to be free together. Other scriptures that we talk about in the different ones in verses that Paul wrote and things about the fact that we should learn together, we should teach each other, we should hold each other up in prayer, we should lift each other when we fall, we should call each other on our garbage. Because free people who have never been free don't necessarily know how to be free. And then what's the better way for free people to figure out what it means to be free, how to define their freedom, than to do it together? What makes more sense than for that to happen and to be guided by the Holy Spirit as is described here in the Scripture? Other places it talks about the fact that because of our freedom, and this is where my rebellion came into effect a little bit when I was a kid or when I was younger, when I became free from everything, I really didn't worry about offense that it would cause others who were Christians, other people of faith, because that was their conscience, this was my conscience, and neither of them, you know, you do what you need to do, I'll do what I do, and it really doesn't matter if it offends you one way or the other. And when I was, as I've matured, I've realized through Scripture, that's not really the way it works. That's not really what we are called to do. Actually, Paul talks a couple different times about people who are free to do certain things and have no hesitation to do it, and people who require some other guidelines. And in Scripture, he talks about people eating food offered to idols and things like that. And we don't really do that very often anymore. I don't know if it happens at all in the United States, but there are other things. Yeah, when I was growing up in my church, and many of you are in the same kind of church, we didn't drink. It was not okay. It was way not okay. As I've matured and as I've read Scripture and things like that, I realize now that that was something that was kind of a guideline, and there were very specific reasons for it. We have people here at this church who do drink, and we have people who don't. And they're both Christians. I'm not saying that, you know, one way or the other, but they are. But when we exercise whichever one we are, whichever side we're on, we exercise it for the sake of rebellion. We exercise that for the sake of without caring about those around us. It becomes a barrier to the development of community. It can become a sin in your life, even if it's not a sin dictated by Scripture. Why is that the case? Because as Galatians says here, we are to do things in love. And if we really don't care how other people feel, we are not doing it in love. We're not exercising our freedom in love. So sometimes we forego things for the sake of those around us, those who, and that's just one example. There are others. But it's hard sometimes, but particularly those of us who, maybe you grew up in a church, and not just me, but others who have grown up in a church that is very legalistic. And when you feel like you've been liberated by some of those things. And so there is no shame in them. And if you want to look more about that, look, you can look into 1 Corinthians. There's some, he does a really good job of explaining that kind of stuff. Romans does some of that too, as far as understanding the proper, you know, the heart behind it. But it's important for us. And if we are to live in community, we are going to actually care about those within our community. Not trying to change them, not ridiculing them for having different viewpoints on that type of thing. That's not sin. The other thing I realized as I was going through this is free people offer freedom to other folks. If you have experienced freedom, really experienced it, and you are learning to live like the one who has set you free, and you are building your faith in community, you are also going to be offering the freedom that you've experienced to the people around you. And it will happen. For me, in my own experience and what I have seen and what many of you have seen, is if people are going closer to Christ, becoming more Christ-like, and if the community is growing in Christ's love for each other, it's magnetic to people. And when people start asking you questions, because you have a defined faith, because you understand what you believe and why you believe it, and you understand that you've given up elements of freedom for the sake of being under the direction of Christ, you can explain that to people, and you can understand it, and they too can be part of that liberated group of people. It works together. We are ministers of the good news, and I'm pretty sure that being set free from bondage is good news. It is good news. And we sometimes forget, I think, because we do get lacking in our desire to live like the liberator, in our desire to get to know Christ better through community. And because of that, we forget the primary thing, which is Christ has set us free. And then we wonder why we don't have conversations about our faith with people who don't know Jesus. We don't understand why the whom the Son sets free is free indeed is not attractive to people who have not been set free by the Son. All of these things work together, and I tried to figure out which one comes first, and there's not really a way to understand that. Free people do these three things. They all affect each other. They spill over. When you are exercising your freedom to follow Christ and to make yourself a slave to the message, to the law of Christ, when you do those things, it pours over. You want to work in community with other folks. You want to see them grow, and you want to grow because of their influence. And because of that, you want to see other people become free and liberated and empowered by the same thing that has changed you, that you have experienced. And then as a result of those new folks coming in, you see people coming to faith, and they want to be like the liberator. And so they're drawn into community. And then they're excited, and they're out there yelling about the freedom of Christ from the mountaintops, from the housetops, because they cannot be they cannot contain the excitement of being someone who has been set free. It is good news. I've got one more passage I want to read to you, and then we're gonna close this up today. At 1 Corinthians 9, starting in verse 19. This is kind of going on to this idea of freedom. Even though I'm a free man with no master, I have become a slave to all people to bring many to Christ. When I was with the Jews, I lived like a Jew to bring the Jews to Christ. When I was with those who follow the Jewish law, I too lived under that law, even though I'm not subject to the law. I did this so I could bring to Christ those who were under the law. When I'm with Gentiles who do not follow Jewish law, I too live apart from the law so I can bring them to Christ. But I do not ignore the law of God. I obey the law of Christ. When I'm with those who are weak, I share their weakness, for I want to bring the weak to Christ. I try to find common ground with everyone, doing everything I can to save them. I do everything to spread the good news and share in its blessings. When I'm with the weak, I'm weak. When I'm with the strong, I'm strong. When I'm with one group, I'm one thing. When I'm with another group, I'm another. It does not mean that you leave your conscience at the door. It does not mean that your definition of sin changes from group to group. But it's understanding the people with whom you are working, the people with whom you serve, and to whom you're ministering. It's important, it's vitally important that we understand that it is good news. And if we are truly freed people, if we are truly experiencing life under the liberator, we are going to do what we can do to bring people into the same freedom we experience. It's a mandate from Christ, but even if he hadn't said that we're supposed to do it, those people who have been set free want other people to be set free. We look at the idea of evangelism or spreading the good news or whatever you want to call it. We look at it as it's a mandate from Christ, so we should all do it. That's true. But so often, that's the only reason. Folks, remember. Those of you who follow Christ, remember. Remember the freedom. Remember the liberation. I don't care if you've become a Christian in the last 2 weeks or whether it was something that with which you've always kind of been around. You've always been around church. You've always been in church. You've been saved from so many other things because your faith started young. Tap into the reality, to the truth that Christ has set you free from the penalty of sin, and he has set you free to be something great in this world through his power and through his Holy Spirit, to affect other people, to bring freedom to other slaves. That is what free people do. That is a definition of freedom with Christ at the top, the community on the left, evangelism, good news on the right, and our just desire to be like Christ. If you imagine in the back, following us and pushing us along. We have a bounded faith, but bounded by the message of Christ, bounded by the truth of what he presents, bounded, defined by Christ, fueled by the Holy Spirit. Fueled by the Holy Spirit, and I've talked about that much today, but being empowered, Scripture talks about us being empowered by the Holy Spirit to do these things. We can't do those things. We can't do it ourselves. We can't liberate slaves on our own. We don't have the power. Christ has the power, and we have been liberated. We are called to live like free people, to define our faith, to define it, because our freedom has to have definition. The quote, I've got a quote. I was reading some other things this week, and I read a quote by Martin Luther, which I think is a great example. It kind of sums it up, and probably I should have just read this and walked off the stage, honestly. A Christian is a perfectly free lord of all, subject to none. A Christian is a perfectly dutiful servant of all, subject to all. I'll give it to you after church. But I'll read it again anyway, because a Christian is a perfectly free lord of all, subject to none when it comes to your liberty. A Christian is a perfectly dutiful servant to all, subject to all. We are called to be free people who will willfully subject ourselves to the servant life that Christ has called us to live. So you have to decide how your freedom is going to affect you, how it's going to affect the world around you. How will your faith be fine? What will be the defining elements of your faith? Where will people see where your faith begins and ends? Where will they see what it is? And it's not the boundaries of do's and don'ts. Bounded by Christ. Bounded by living life like Christ. Bounded by the community to which he calls us and the world to which he calls us to reach out. That's the definition. Those are the defining elements of our faith. What are you going to do with them? Where do you need to work out a little bit? Where do you need to lose a little bit of water weight? Where do you need to cut out some of those things so that the definition is there? Where are you just playing lip service? I can't tell you the number of meetings I've had over the last 10 or 11 years where we discuss the importance of community and evangelism and discipleship, which is basically what we're talking about when we talk about being Christ-like, being a follower of Christ. I can't tell you the number of meetings I've had where I go out feeling great. And then, if we really got a shot, even of our group who were in leadership, it's flabby. We'd be laughed off a stage because there is no definition. Community is important, but I will not do anything to encourage community. Evangelism is important, but someone else has got to do it. Caring for the community is important, and I will talk about it and maybe write a check. Being a Christ-like is important, but don't ask me to do a Bible study. Don't ask me to be part of something that is going to push me along. Christ is important. He is the center of everything we do. He has set us all free. Just don't ask us to talk about it. Just don't ask us to let it define the decisions we make. We, as Christians, Western Christians are the worst, but as Christians, it's a human nature. We want to experience the freedom of the salvation. We do not want the definition that the freedom requires. I'm not saying it to be mean. I am in the same boat. I've been in every one of those meetings. And I've walked out equally guilty. Some of you may wonder why numbers are down, why other things seem to be happening in other places. Growth is happening and you're confused by it. You love the church, you don't understand. I'm convinced when we begin to define our faith, we become more defined people of Christ. We will become magnetic to the world around us. We will be living like freed slaves. Freed slaves. What will you do? Where does it need some work? What will you do with the freedom that you've been given today? Because ultimately, there's a will involved. It's your will. Willfully subjecting yourself to servitude. Willingly subjecting yourself to the slave life. To following Christ. It's willful. So what will you do this morning with it? How will you allow freedom, your freedom to be defined?